Welcome back. You've just tuned into NTV. You're watching Talking Point. This is the third segment. Our guest today is Dr. Habib Rahman, an international academic consultant. Dr. Rahman, you're basically a physicist. You're also an academic consultant. You have done a lot of research on so many aspects, and as you just mentioned about the technology in our pocket, the mobile phones, the radios, the laptops, and all that. But you have your own views on evolution and the creation of the universe, the Big Bang theory, how the universe expanded, and also how is it going to break up in billions of years, perhaps. See.
Yeah, so you have touched a very soft corner in my heart. Those were the topics of my very younger days at Carleton University in Canada, where I was doing my PhD studies in high energy physics. As I said before, I changed it later on. During those 2 years, our task was to do a lot of coursework, like the normal system in Canada and the United States. And other aspect was to conduct research. So I picked up this cosmology. The whole subject in a broader scale is called cosmology. And we would investigate what is the origin of the Big Bang, how the universe was created, and of course, who created it. So in short, it's a very big thing, but because of the time, I'll just summarize it for you. There are a lot of theories of Big Bang is only one theory, and which is the most dominant. And the father of all these things, as you know, was Albert Einstein. So based on his general theory of relativity, what was predicted at that time that our universe is governed by four forces. One, electromagnetic force that gives us light and everything, you know it. Second, gravitational force that is keeping us glued to the earth, others would be flown away. And the third one is not very commonly known, is called strong nuclear force. And fourth one is also not known, is called electro weak force. Now the last two ones occurs within a subatomic level, inside the atom. So let's talk about the first two very briefly. So Einstein predicted that our universe is governed by these four forces. But when Allah created this universe at a certain time, all these forces were together, only one force. But they fragmented into four later on. So it's called unification of all fundamental forces. That was our research at that time. So at the time of Big Bang, now why the Big Bang should occur? So according to science, that there was certain time, technically we call it 10 to the power minus 43 second, minus 43 second, the age of the universe at that time. So you can imagine it's almost zero. So, but Allah has already created the matter. So the matter, because the volume was almost zero, that matter was very condensed to almost a very, very small volume. And because of that highly compressed state, the entire universe at that time, or the matter at that time, existed at a very excited state. Because it was very compressed. There was a very strong pressure. And that at that time,
the pressure from within
it's an within, you know, because it's like, just like I tell you, suppose you get say an apple or an orange, and you put that orange under pressure, what will happen? It will break, and it will fragment, you know, it will splinter into ground here and there. So the idea was that the universe existed. Allah created that, but nobody knows how he created. You cannot go beyond that time. That is the whole mystery here. But after that, you cannot go to the time t equal to zero. That part is unknown to anyone. But
you can imagine minus 43 seconds.
You can imagine 10 to the power minus 43 seconds. Mm-hmm. At that time, these things were occurring. So there was certain volume, there was certain mass, mm-hmm. you know, but God has already created this. Whatever you see in this universe, He didn't create later on.
Mm-hmm.
It was there, but it was compressed in a very zero volume. And because that compression, the whole matter came under pressure and exploded. It's called fireball, Big Bang.
Right.
So when it exploded, it expanded very fast.
Mm-hmm.
So scientists said that it expanded at the rate of 10 to the power 120, almost infinity.
Mm-hmm.
It was expanding very fast. So when it started expanding, along the way...
We are not talking about the Earth, we are talking about the universe.
Oh yeah, not Earth. Earth is a small part of the whole universe, the whole universe. So when it started expanding, the space was created. That's mm-hmm. where the Einstein general theory of relativity came. You know, this space is being created
mm-hmm.
along the way. How this space created? Because of that Big Bang and highly compression and explosion,
mm-hmm.
they were traveling very fast. And as they were traveling very fast, the particles, they are losing their velocity and energy. And when they were losing and colliding with each other, they formed atoms,
mm-hmm.
they formed molecules, and they created the fabric of the space-time curvature. That's a technical term for the space.
Mm-hmm.
So they created, and at that time, according to that Big Bang theory or the cosmology, these forces were created. For example, atom was created because neutron, proton, they collided together
mm-hmm.
and they stayed together, and electron started orbiting that. So it's electromagnetic force. So it was created. Then, because they were traveling fast, something was pulling them back. That is the gravitation.
Mm-hmm.
So the gravitational mm-hmm. force was mm-hmm. being created. Then
so there must be some mutual gravitational force, isn't it? Because they are staying at their own orbits.
At that time there was no orbit. I'm mm-hmm. just talking about a very, very early state of the universe. So it was just to give an idea to the audience here, it is like as you are pulling a string.
Right.
So the string is hooked to a certain point
mm-hmm.
in the wall
mm-hmm.
and you are trying to pull it.
Yes.
So the wall will not let it go.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the gravitation, as if something is pulling you back. So what was pulling back was that Big Bang when it was created.
Mm-hmm.
The particles are traveling. They wanted to get away from the source of the Big Bang. And they had to travel with a very high velocity of light. But as they were traveling, they were losing energy. And they are losing velocity.
Mm-hmm.
So they had to slow down. And when they slowed down, as if something is pulling them back. You see, that's how the slowdown created the gravitational pull.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how we got the gravitation. And because of that gravitational pull, whatever space these particles created, it became curved. We call it became
mm-hmm.
warped.
Mm-hmm.
So the space became curved like this, you know. That is that one. Then
how long would it have been in terms of our time?
In time of our time, it's a very intelligent question. That phenomena occurred when the universe was at the age of 10 to the power minus 43 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
Between that time to 10 to the power minus 10 seconds, now it is coming. Universe is about very small age at that time, very insignificant age. So when the universe reached 10 to the minus 10 second, these things are occurring.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So the theory of physics is known at up to that point. And beyond that 10 to the minus 43, you don't know mm-hmm. what was happening.
Mm-hmm.
So the forces were created in a very fraction of a second, you know, forces were created. And then the theory came that as they started traveling, new particles were being created. And along the way, they were curving the space, and then they were joining with each other, creating atom molecules. And then inside the atom, these neutron and protons, these particles that constitute the nucleus, they were colliding with each other. And when they collide with each other, they create this nuclear force,
right.
As I mentioned.
You have written somewhere that it gave rise to exotic, the birth of exotic particles.
Yes.
What are the exotic particles?
What are the exotic particles? Let me tell you. Here, because I'm speaking to you from Great Britain,
right.
I'm speaking to the audience. In this country produced some of the greatest minds in this area.
Mm-hmm.
So we had Professor Higgs, you know, he just got Nobel Prize, I think, last year.
Yeah.
So one particle that was created at that time is called Higgs boson.
Mm-hmm.
But Bose was an Indian scientist. He yeah. also predicted at a very early state of the universe because of the extreme heat.
Mm-hmm.
The temperature at that time was 10 to the power 33 Kelvin at that time. So can you imagine? 10 to the power 33 degree Kelvin.
My thoughts melt.
Yeah. It was even more than what the interior temperature of the interior of Sun today.
Mm-hmm.
So he... And along with Bose, they predicted that because of the intense heat and very high velocity of these particles, when they collide with each other, they will produce a third particle. And that third particle will be responsible for carrying energy
mm-hmm.
from point A to point B. So that is called Higgs boson. It's an excited, exotic particle.
Mm-hmm.
That's one particle. There was another scientist at Imperial College. You might have heard his name. His name was Professor Abdus Salam.
Yeah.
He was from Pakistan. He predicted that inside the nucleus, there is a constant interaction is happening between occurring between neutron and proton. And because of the constant interaction, it is like, just to give an example for the audience here, that if you have a fuse, you know, and
yeah.
if you short circuit the fuse, there can be an electronic shorts here, and you can see the flickering of light.
Yeah.
So between neutron and proton, here is a neutron, here is a proton, and if they come close to, very close to each other, an electronic signal exchange.
Yeah.
And that exchange takes place, is carried by a particle.
Mm-hmm.
And that particle is called, we used to call winnows, W's,
mm-hmm.
W plus minus, winnows.
Mm-hmm.
And that part, and there is another particle called omega.
Mm-hmm.
Particle,
yeah.
and those particles were predicted by Abdus Salam and his colleagues,
right.
and they got Nobel Prize. He got Nobel Prize in 1979.
Yeah.
But what is the significance of these things? Why we are spending billions of dollars in this? The reason is that the people wanted to know that if these particles were created, then they can understand the origin of the birth of the
right.
universe, okay? And they had to somehow simulate experiments to generate these particles. Fortunately, here in Europe, we have a large accelerator center, CERN,
mm-hmm.
Center for European Nuclear Research, based in Geneva. There are many in America and other countries. And they bombarded particles with each other,
yeah.
and they got this particle, the signature of this particle.
How interesting. Dr.
Yeah.
Habib, I would like to ask you a question about you visited Bangladesh quite often, and probably you'll be visiting soon. We have so many universities, so many colleges, so many independent universities, so many private universities. Those days of just Dhaka University and Rajshahi and Chittagong are gone, where the best of the best got the chance, see. What is the level, what kind of education is being imparted, and are they being readied for the market beyond their graduation?
Thank you for this question, but before I touch it, you asked me, I want to close what I was saying before
yes.
you asked me.
We don't have much time.
Yeah, I understand. The universe is expanding and thinning out. So as it thins out, it is losing the density. And after 5 billion years, all the forces mm-hmm. will vanish and universe will
mm-hmm.
die.
Mm-hmm.
That is the prediction
okay.
of that era. But unfortunately, we don't have much time.
Mm-hmm.
Now, going back to my eldest brother used to tell me some years ago that you are getting education in advanced societies. When you go there, try to understand what makes them tick. Why are they so developed?
Right.
What is the difference between us and them? Because we are the same human being. Why should they develop themselves faster than us? What is the problem? Except for the resources.
Mm-hmm.
So I still remember my brother's advice, and I paid my attention. What I see that in our country, we have very high quality faculty members, there is no doubt. We have got very high quality talented students, there is no doubt. But our system is not there to carry them.
Mm-hmm.
The system is is not taking them and making them competing, you know, with the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. Our programs, we have large number of universities, but we do not have what is now known as learning outcome oriented program. That what is the, as I said,
What is the best way to achieve this?
The best way to achieve this would be, I have written to many universities in Bangladesh, Break University, Open University, American University in Dhaka, and so on. So I'm in touch with them.
Have you received any response?
Yes, they said that please come, when you come home, come and meet us, we will work together to make our education applied and learning oriented.
We hope that when you go next time, you will talk to them and you will advise them how to improve
them.
Things.
We'll work together.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much
for giving
me this time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, viewers, for being with us, and I hope that you have enjoyed the show as much as we have today. Just to inform you that our programs are uploaded regularly on YouTube, and you can watch this program on YouTube. You can watch us on Line through NTV player, you can watch us on your mobile, and you can watch us on your obviously television screens. So same time, same channel, next week with another distinguished guest, inshallah. See you again. In the meantime, take care.